Well, welcome to this very first webinar in our Healthy Pastors, Healthy Families series. My name is Annie Rose, and it is my delight and pleasure to serve the EPC as the Director of Ministerial Support and Development. And I'm especially pleased tonight to be joined by my good friend and colleague in ministry, Roy Yanke. We're going to hear from Roy in just a bit, but this webinar series is a partnership between the EPC and PIR Ministries. And Roy is the executive director of PIR, so it's fitting that he is kicking us off tonight. Why are we holding this series of webinars entitled Healthy Pastors, Healthy Families? We want the EPC to be a family of churches where pastors and their families can be real people with real struggles and experience the real grace, compassion, and love of Jesus. And yet we know that we have a ways to go to make that happen. And so these webinars are just a small step toward beginning some important conversations on topics that may touch on needs in your life or in the life of your family that have gone unaddressed up to this point. And the webinars are also a great opportunity to highlight some important resources for you to be aware of as you become aware of needs either in your own life or in the lives of your loved ones. Just a quick logistical note tonight, as we hear from Roy, you are going to have an opportunity to interact with him through our anonymous Q&A. So if you look toward the bottom of your Zoom screen, hopefully somewhere, you see a little icon that says Q&A. Feel free to submit those questions. And after we've heard from Roy, Roy will have a chance to interact with as many as we can before we're out of time tonight. So that will be the way that we're able to interact with one another, but still preserve some anonymity here so that you can feel completely comfortable in whatever you need to ask tonight. Well, Roy has agreed to talk with us tonight about embracing our stories. A big part of our ability to experience the freedom and joy of Jesus Christ is being able to embrace our own stories in all of their joy and glory and all their messiness, knowing that we serve a God who redeems even the broken parts of our lives. We serve a God who works through the realities of human life. So I'm thankful, Roy, that you've agreed to be with us tonight. Looking forward to hearing a bit of your story as you invite us to consider how the Lord might be working through our stories as well. So please share with us.
Thanks, Annie. Can you hear me okay? All right, great.
You got it.
All right. So this is a joy and a privilege to be able to co-host with this with Annie and the EPC. You know, we are an approved resource for the whole denomination as we work with you as pastors and ministry leaders to try and promote ministry health. So that's what we're really all about. I guess at the end, I'll give you a little bit more of a spiel about who we are and some of the resources that we offer. But I serve as the executive director of this ministry. I've been doing that now for 6 years, part of the ministry for 12 in total. And but that hasn't always been the case. So I have not always been a part of this ministry or doing this work. We decided in putting these webinars together to make sure that we talked about our stories, because stories are powerful. And they are liberating, and they create safe spaces. And so I wanted to share a little bit about my story with you this evening, and then talk about some of the things that I've learned along the way in that story. So as I said, stories are powerful, and they've always been a part of my life. I was introduced to science fiction reading by my grandmother when I was very young. And so stories have always captured my heart and had a huge place in my reading and in my life. I love historical novels as well. And I'm also more recently captivated by the latest PBS masterpiece mystery story. And the thing about stories that's so interesting and powerful is that they draw us beyond the facts and the events. The narratives reveal to us the emotional and even sometimes the spiritual currents that connect those events and connect those characters together And it allows us to see the lives of those characters in relation to those events. And it's that character development that has always been really important to me in the stories. And stories are powerful for us on a personal level as well. I have never taken advantage of it, but you can probably think of the explosion recently and people using ancestry.com, you know, wanting to know their roots and to help them understand who and where they are in the line of their family tree. And when it comes to our health and life and ministry, engaging with our personal stories is critically important. And even more so, coming to the place we can embrace our stories is even more important. Now, you may or may not, depending on if we've ever crossed paths, know me as a person who cares deeply about pastors and their challenges. But to help you understand why that is and how my story has shaped that compassion, let me take you back to a night when I sat in a cell in a police station having been arrested after committing the last of 13 bank robberies. So I want to back up and fill in what led up to that momentous occasion. So part one of the story. In elementary school, I had what is unfortunately a far too common experience. I had an early introduction to pornography. And for me, it tapped into something deep, something I had, even to this day, don't understand exactly what that was. As Augustine noted at some place, that we are all prone to the propensity to disordered loves. And so that and the family system that was already in place and at work created the fertile ground for what was going to come. I grew up in a nominally religious home, and I certainly never anticipated the work that God would do in my life that would lead me to become a pastor. Jesus called me to himself while I was in high school and gave me life. Now, the usual assumption I think that we make is that this new life that Jesus gives would have included a swift dealing with the sexual baggage that I was carrying. The baggage that started when I was introduced to pornography as an elementary school kid and would eventually, unresolved, haunt me for many, many years. But the places that we would hope where we would find some understanding and help were not readily apparent for me. My father, who you would think would be the first person to help guide a young man into understanding what was going on and all those undercurrents of sexuality, had his own issues with this. And so there was no guidance or understanding available to me. And in the church culture, after coming to the Lord and being involved in the church, this issue was not discussed except to say, don't act out on it. Now, that can happen with anything, any addiction, any emotional wound, any trauma, any abuse. The church has seldom assumed baggage in new believers. And the struggles that the church has had to account for just how deep our brokenness can go are pretty evident. Jesus came to save broken people, full stop. In most of our churches, and certainly that was my experience. And often how this brokenness is mended is minimized, and the dissonance begins between who we are and what we have brought to our walk with Jesus and what is expected of us in the church. So just stop it. Rather than having our perspectives reshaped by compassionate and honest discipleship. So after graduating from Bible college, I spent 17 years as a pastor. And God was gracious to use me to do some really good stuff during that time. But I brought all that unresolved baggage with me. and the secret life underneath slowly but surely began choking my soul. It truncated my relationships, and it deepened the shame that was already there. And what I would later understand is a cycle began during that time. Always feeling that I was not enough, I would first try to do a lot of good things, but that never answered the issue deep inside my soul. So in trying to medicate that unresolved shame, I would act out sexually, which then required me to manage my sin, ending in a great sense of isolation that certainly results when we try to handle all of these kinds of things on our own. But just like any addiction, these behaviors escalated over time. I pursued acting out in a number of ways, with steadily increasing involvement and frequency. The consequences of my choices began to leak out all over, seeping into every aspect of my life, including my finances due to my acting out. Secrecy from everyone and hiding became the norm for me. And as for most pastors and ministry leaders, those of us in the public eye and in places of leadership in the church, there's a point at which there seems to be too much to lose and no sense of a way out, a deepening and greater isolation. And the message of victory and the unspoken message that we sometimes get of simply get your act together resonated loud and clear through all of this time. Here's an important point. When hiding begins, we repeat the behavior of our first parents. And because of shame, we can't talk about it, especially in the church. So we set a course to try to fix it ourselves. Shame is a sense of I am wrong versus guilt, which is I've done wrong. And the lie is that we buy into from the evil one is no one else deals with this, which contributes to our sense of isolation. And if I tell on myself, people will run away. So we attempt to control and do sin management. And that always, always leads to larger consequences. So then, in an act of sheer desperation, I robbed my first bank. And this was a completely deluded effort to cover my tracks financially and leave this sinful lifestyle behind. But in reality, all I was doing was trying a new way to manage my sin. All the while that this was going on over those 17 plus years, much longer, you know, whenever you start the clock from coming to know Jesus to that point in time, I was praying desperately that God would take this sin from me magically. Not realizing that that's really not the way he works most of the time. It's rare that that occurs. And when he did show up, it was in a way I had hoped would never occur. On that day in 1991, the two worlds that I had been living came crashing together. And it was not pretty. But it was, in retrospect, an act of God's severe mercy. I had been arrested after that 13th robbery. Here's another point to keep in mind as we talk about embracing our stories. Before we can embrace our stories, we have to acknowledge them. In the 12-step program, one of the first steps is that we had to admit that we were powerless over whatever it was that was controlling us. So the hiding that we do in these cases has to begin to end. And I say that it begins to end because there is another chapter to this story, one that demonstrates there's no quick fix to these kinds of challenges that we face. So now we enter part two. I served 7 years in federal prison. And during that time, I began the journey to understanding myself and the depth of my sin and the reality of God's grace and the truth about how I had tried wrongly to live my life in Christ. And God brought people into my life during that time who would get me started on really understanding my story and fully acknowledging it. There was an unjaded Bureau of Prison psychologist who didn't know better, and some other friends who came alongside during that time and really helped me begin to understand and unpack this part of my life. And that's the next step. Understand where you are in your story. It's like that map in the mall, if you still go to malls, that says, you are here, okay? There's work to be done. There's places to go from there. But there's also grace given for the past so that we don't get lost in regret or even deeper shame. Because sometimes acknowledging our story without a sense of moving forward, without hope, without a sense of God's presence in that process, can land us in a very bad place of despair and being overwhelmed by our shame. So those 7 years, and the 15 actually that followed that, so 22 in total, were days of hard work for me, unpacking the baggage, walking the slow walk of restoration. And the interior work that needed to be done has to be done. And I found that in that sense also, time is our friend in the process. In 1997, I was released from prison and returned to my wife and family who had been patiently and faithfully walking with me and waiting for me through all of those years. I am absolutely delighted to share that this year, Deb and I will celebrate 50 years of marriage together. And she has her own story that goes along with this one that I'm sharing with you. Now, after being released, I had absolutely no hope or aspirations of returning to ministry or getting within 10 miles of it, for that matter. I concluded, and rightly so at that point, that that door was forever closed to me as far as I was concerned. It was just not going to be anything on the radar again. So I embarked on a new path and began to work in industry and manufacturing in the Detroit area. Excuse me. And there was a lot of inner work that was done during that time period. But the important thing to remember too is while I was doing inner work intentionally myself, I did not do that alone during that period of time. There were years of accountability in 12-step groups. There were friends who walked with me sharing their own stories as we went along. There was the full disclosure of my story and challenges with church leadership. There was, just probably the best part of it is there was a small group who embraced us and our story with grace and love for almost 25 years. And certainly my wife, who was and is always my biggest advocate and help in unpacking the baggage on a daily basis. So doing this work doesn't happen alone. Certainly we do it ourselves intentionally and intimately, but there is that relational aspect as well. These were people who created safe spaces for me to do the work of understanding my story, to look at the shame, to ask the big question of why in order to get at the root causes, to erase those negative family voices that I heard far too often, and to stop medicating the dissonance that I felt. So it's important that we recognize that we understand who we are and how we arrived wherever we are. Otherwise, we will always be fighting the dissonance between what we think we should be, or others tell us we should be, and who we really are. So there has to be acknowledgement, and there has to be a growing understanding of why this took place, how it happened, how did we get here to that point on the map? You are here. Now, these people also gave me a tremendous gift, and that was the gift of beginning to embrace my story. And when I say embrace it, I mean to own it and to speak it and to be able to share it. And that's what embracing really is, owning it. All the parts, good, bad, ugly, that have shaped who I am under God's hand. Now, I wish that I could tell you that this process of understanding and eventually embracing my story is a straight line of uninterrupted growth. I wish I could tell you that. It's sort of what we would like to imagine what our investments actually look like, right? That graph. Truthfully, our stories often mimic what the stock market actually does, which is a lot of ups and downs. It's more like a sine wave. But the trajectory can be and always has been for me into greater health, no matter what that has looked like along the way. Another aspect for me that's really important is reflecting back on God's presence all along the way. And to some degree, this is more of a recent revelation to me in embracing my story. When I consider his call to follow Jesus, knowing the mess that was going on in my heart, to getting married to my best friend, who has endured much but never given up, to the clear call into ministry that I had, knowing the great cancer of unaddressed baggage that still lived in me, to the unmerited protection when my actions could have led, frankly, to being shot or to committing suicide. His kindness and mercy have been instrumental always in my ongoing repentance. And it's important, I think, in embracing our stories to not ignore that piece, because it is the fundamental piece, because we live under God's sovereign grace in his hand. And he's not surprised. He's never been surprised by anything that we do, but his grace is always there, and his kindness does lead us to repentance. I'll tell that piece a little bit later. And so that was part two. And it never occurred to me that God might have other plans in the future. But then again, I've only slowly begun to realize just how well he works behind the scenes. So part three of this story begins in 2012 and extends beyond that. A number of events coalesced into opening the next and current chapter in my story. There was the blessing that my pastor gave over me unexpectedly in 1998, when we first entered the doors of that church. After sharing my story with him, he looked at me and he said, "Your best years of ministry are ahead of you." Now, I don't know that he would claim to be a prophet, but that was certainly one of those anticipatory blessings that sometimes we have the privilege of receiving. So there was that. Then there was the slow re-entry into ministry on a local church level. And by slow, I mean years of sticking my toe in and finding places where I could serve without notoriety, and eventually moving into other leadership places until I became a ruling elder and was ordained in that. Then there were the long drives on Sunday afternoons with Deb, where we could talk and share and unpack stuff, and where at one point I could ask, "Do you think God would be angry with me if I thought about going back into ministry again?" And another piece of that that goes with that is the affirmation of others as time went on, that it was likely he wouldn't be angry. And then there was the random meeting, random in the kingdom of God, with someone who was very familiar with PIR Ministries and encouraged me to believe that my story could be an asset to the kingdom of God and not a liability. So joining the PIR team after the long wait has allowed me to fully embrace my story. I have the joy and the privilege and the freedom to share it with pastors who need to know that God is not done with them yet. No matter how long or how hard the journey might be, he has not given up on them. In the last 12 years, because of God's mercy and grace and love, have afforded me the opportunity to share my story and point pastors and churches to the God who restores and never gives up. It also gives me the opportunity to create safe spaces for those in ministry who have their own stories that need to be embraced. And it occurred to me that we do create safe spaces by sharing our stories and by allowing others to then share theirs. And in the process, to further our own sense of not being alone as we continue the healing of our own souls. Now, this story is unfinished, as are all our stories, until the day that he issues that final call to come home. It has been a steady journey, even though it's been marked by occasional missteps and struggles. I want to be real about that. That, as I said, there are no quick fixes. And for many of us, these are lifelong stories and lifelong journeys. It remains an ongoing journey and continues to reflect, I hope, the great love and grace of God in reshaping a life in the image of His Son. So I'm learning to address the shame continually that plunged me into darkness those years ago, and every day to say a wholehearted yes to Jesus as Lord and Savior, and it allows me to continue to heal and to be restored. And others who are safe are still a big part of the healing in my life. So it's never a one and done. It's not the hard intentional work and then, I can move on without others to still be in my life. So what I'd like to do in a few moments is just then highlight some of the big principles that I've come to appreciate as my story has unfolded, if I may. The first is the importance of embracing our stories, which is the title of this webinar and what I've been sharing with you, beginning with acknowledging and understanding them. We need to understand who we are and how we arrived here, wherever here is at this moment in time. Otherwise, as I said, we will always be fighting against the dissonance between what we think we should be and what we are and who we are. And also in that process, acknowledging and appreciating the God story that he is writing in you. He is the God who redeems and renews and never leaves. When I think back and reflect on all of that, I am amazed to realize that I have always been loved. God's face has never been turned away from me. And I know that theologically that's because he did turn his face away from Jesus on the cross and when he was bearing all of our sins. But still, we sometimes wonder, have I gone too far and God's face is turned away from me? I'm not so sure that's ever the case. There may be. I want to be appropriately uncertain about that. But I do believe that in most of our lives, God's face still shines on us. The other thing that's really, really important in this is that whatever our challenges may be, the inner work is needed, and it is needed intimately, personally, and in relationship. Sometimes we get the idea that if I just gut it out and figure it out on my own, that we can fix it. And that always got me into trouble. It's in relationship that this work really begins to take form and shape. And part of that is the unpacking of the baggage, which means we simply grow in self-awareness. We start to get at those root causes of why. And as we talk about our stories, some of those things become clearer and more reachable when we actually do share them. In Nouwen's book, The Wounded Healer, this is a really important passage that I had underlined in that book. He says, the man, or in parentheses for me, a woman, who can articulate the movements of their inner life, who can give names to the varied experiences, need no longer be a victim of themselves, but is slowly and consistently able to remove the obstacles that prevent the spirit from entering. He is able to create space for the spirit, whose heart is greater than his or hers, whose eyes see more than his, and whose hands can heal more than his. That just really captures that whole piece, is that we need to be able to do that inner work and to name those things and do the digging. But then it's the important piece of knowing that we're simply removing the obstacles for the spirit to do the deep work that only he can do. So humility and being human open the door for authentically asking the why questions that can sometimes be really difficult to answer, but important. And for the vulnerability that we need to invite others into the process. And I will, as you could probably testify, each of us, this is really hard work. This is not comfortable. This is not stuff you do quickly. It's hard work, but it is so, so very important. Who you are and where you are in the process right now of embracing your story actually informs how you do ministry, how you are in that. If there is hiding, if there are secrets, if there's no relationships that are creating safe spaces for you, for whatever reason, the baggage that has yet to be unpacked, the challenges that need to be acknowledged, will shape how you go about your calling. Ministry flows out of those inner places, out of the inner landscape of the soul. And it may be a good question even tonight or tomorrow to ask, what does that landscape look like today for me? Because your health or unhealth in this way impacts so much more than you can imagine. It certainly impacts how you do ministry, but it impacts your relationship with others, with family, with the church, with life. And so it's vitally important that we do this inner work and grow in that self-awareness. Without that, I would not be where I am today. Another part of that inner work, though, that we need to make sure of is that it is that relational piece. And that first relationship that we need to have is the relationship with Jesus. And it's nurtured through the ordinary means of grace, which includes word and sacrament, which we are all familiar with. But I don't. So I will deny I said this, that the ordinary means of grace are much broader and deeper than just those two things. I also believe that for me, I have experienced ordinary grace that has been vital in my recovery and renewal. In those unfettered times of silence and solitude where God's presence and voice are palpable, that's an ordinary means of grace that's within reach for all of us. And it's in that context that our relationship with Jesus, which is the first relationship that we need to be concerned about, really begins to impact our renewal and our recovery. Ann Voskamp put out a podcast, I think it was yesterday, if I remember right. Anyway, it was very recent. And she was talking about this whole identity issue and who we are and our relationship with God in that process. And this is really a cool quote. She says, "Identity is given, not generated." And she's, if I remember right, she is bouncing off of Tim Keller's statement, because he made a similar statement at some point. Identity is embraced, not earned. Intimately knowing who we are only happens when we intimately know God. A relationship with God precedes having any relationship with who we really are. And I 100% agree with that. But I also believe that in conjunction with that, there's a circle that takes place. Because our relationship with God does precede knowing our true selves and growing in self-knowledge and self-awareness leads to a greater understanding of God and his relationship to us. So it's not an either-or proposition. It is a circle that begins to take shape in our lives. Teresa of Avila and Augustine often talked about we cannot know God until we know ourselves. And so we cannot know ourselves until we know God, because knowledge of him precedes that. But then there is the other piece of growing in our own self-knowledge, which deepens our understanding of who God is. And I hope, I know it has for me, that ultimately all of that piece of relationship with Jesus leads us to understand that God cares more about us, more about you, than any ministry you might do for him. Sometimes, as I did, we can feel like there's too much to lose. But Jesus said, "What does it profit us if we lose our own soul?" And so God loves you. Jesus came and died for you, not for your ministry. And so knowing that can bring a tremendous amount of freedom to step into understanding and embracing our stories. And then relationally, there's that other piece, those other people, those people who are the hands and feet of Jesus, the voice of Jesus sometimes in our face when we need it, and others, those others who make room for us in safety and in hope. We need hope, but we also need others to hope for us. Sometimes we cannot hope for ourselves. We are so locked into shame. We are so locked into feeling like this will never change. There's too much to lose. I can't control this. So we need others to hope for us on our behalf. Those are advocates. I love people who are advocates for me and for others. And we need others to hope with us, not to stand aloof, but to be engaged and to come alongside of us and say, yes, there is a God who does never get, who never gives up. Now, we all need to find those safe spaces, whether it's counselors, and they are important, or friends, of which I had none while I was in my early years of ministry, or cohorts of those with similar struggles, like 12-step groups or Celebrate Recovery, or you know, other things that are out there that you can join into and be a part of what other people are sharing. We need those advocates, the people who will listen and not try to fix, people of grace and prayer. So we have to have others at work in our lives. We are such a culture of do-it-yourself, wild, wild west style, and that never brings the flourishing and the health that we hope for and that we all need. You need people who will tell you you're not alone, that you belong, that you are loved, and you will not be left behind. Another piece, and I mentioned this in passing earlier, that I feel is really important in this is the grace to embrace in our stories the time that it takes to get there, to work through the acknowledgement and the understanding and to the embracing. There has to be patience and leaning into daily grace. We are too rushed in most of everything, and I think we all feel that. And this work of embracing our story, whatever the challenge may be, emotionally, mentally, addiction, whatever, that work is not simple and it's not easy because the baggage that we carry has deep pockets. And at the same time, God is really not in any rush to bring us into that place of health and healing. He's in no rush with us. I love what Paul says in Philippians 2:12. He says, "Therefore, my dear friends, as you have always obeyed, not only in my presence, but now much more in my absence, continue to work out your salvation with fear and trembling." And I love the way Peterson paraphrases that. He says, "Reverent and sensitive. For it is God who works in you to will and to act in accordance to fill his good pleasure." And that's a lifetime. That's a lifetime. So time is our friend, and we need to embrace it and allow it to have its good work in us so that we aren't rushed and we don't miss those places that really need to be attended to along the way. And the last thing that I feel like I've learned and I'm learning out of all of this is that embracing our story allows them to be used by God for his glory and for the good of others. I remember hearing a long time ago the story of Corrie Ten Boom, and she used the image of needlepoint to describe how it is that on our side, we see all these random threads and colors that make absolutely no sense. And yet, if you flip it over, there is the pattern. There is the picture. And we can wonder, how can any of this really matter at all or be used for good? How can my life, at whatever point we are, make any difference? How can it be something that honors God? Well, all the seemingly random threads of our life, the wounds and the winds, fit into that larger picture of God's sovereign plan for us and for his kingdom by his lavish grace and love. And so it does work for his glory. And by embracing our stories and finding ways to appropriately share them when the time is right, it certainly honors him, because then it becomes his story that he has written. And sharing our stories also creates safe places for others where they can find their way to hope as well. One of the greatest privileges that I have in doing this work, apart from all the administrative stuff and everything else that I have to do, is to be able to sit across the table in a coffee shop from a pastor and be able to say to them, "I don't know how long it's going to take or what it's going to look like, but I know this without a doubt, that God is not done with you yet. And as long as I'm around, I'll walk with you and we'll see what he wants to do." You know, if we actually do a survey of the stories of those in Scripture, it sort of reveals that even the heroes of our faith were human, go figure, and had their own baggage and challenges. I was reflecting on this today and just thinking about Saul and, you know, the possibility that he was bipolar, or Moses, who had his own issues of self-doubt, or Jeremiah, holy cow, who went through tremendous bouts of depression and questioning God. You know, God is not afraid to tell those stories for us. And God is not ashamed of those people because of their challenges and their stories. And when they were able to embrace them, Saul not so much, but when those who were able to embrace it, embraced it, then it became something that God could be really glorified in. So God's not afraid of our stories or anybody else's. Now, I want to be real here, because when we talk about embracing our stories and getting to that point where perhaps we can share them, there is a risk sometimes in disclosure. I want to be honest about that. And unfortunately, in the work that we do, we have seen how the church sometimes still cannot stomach people being human and continuing to be broken in their journey, even while he continues to redeem them. Not everyone in every church, or every church for that matter, or even a denomination is safe. And so we have to be selective sometimes, but we have to find those safe places, and we have to be able to share our stories and embrace them fully in order for our healing to continue, as well as to be a blessing to others. I think about Paul in Romans 7. Now, that you can theologically argue with me at some point about whether this was Paul actually, or he was being, you know, metaphorical here. But I believe it was Paul. I think there's a lot of evidence for that. And I'm absolutely sure that it was a bit of a risk for someone who already had his enemies to own his story and his own challenges and struggles with sin, even recounting in some places the whole of his journey. Paul was not afraid to do that. He somehow arrived at that place where he can just tell his story, because it was God's story and it pointed to the God who redeems. Now, not every story ends well, but I believe that it can, and it does. Some issues that we face do require us to think about our ministry roles. If ministry is exacerbating the inner turmoil and the dissonance in our souls. And that certainly was true for me when I was pastoring. The stresses and strains and the weight of ministry life put fuel on the fire of that shame and that never being enough idea for me. So we have to think about that. We have to think about what's healthy and where we and others are safe. And what could possibly be the new and better shape of our calling? And that was true for me when I could arrive at the place where I felt there was affirmation of returning to a ministry life. It became then a matter of deciding what kind of ministry would be healthy for me and be a blessing to others and not be harmful to others. And so not going back into pastoral ministry meant that I was given the opportunity by God's grace to step into this work, which, again, has been a tremendous blessing and grace in my life. So, whoever you are, and wherever you are now, this is the place to start. This is the you are here point in your story, your point on the map. And I want to say to you, as you're listening to this, there is healing and freedom and joy in embracing our stories, of working through that process of acknowledging and understanding and embracing. So let me pray for us, if I might. Father God, thank you from the depths of our being that the scriptures are true, that you know how we are made, that you see the inmost workings of our souls, that everything about us is as bright as it is for us when we stand outside in the sun. And yet you do not turn your face away from us. Through Jesus, your Son, and his work for us, you have decided that we have value and worth in your sight. and you have done all that you can, and you are doing all that you can to bring us to that place where we are whole and healthy. And we know, Lord, that's a lifelong journey, but it is one worth taking. So I pray for my brothers and sisters here tonight, and any who might listen beyond tonight, that we will find the grace and find those others who can hope with and for us, so that we can begin that journey of embracing our stories and find the healing and hope that we need. Thank you, God, for your great grace and mercy and your kindness. We love you and praise you for your generosity to us. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. Thank you so much, Roy. It's just such a gift to, knowing the amazing ministry that the Lord has given you in this chapter of your life. Such a gift to have you lead out with this series by sharing your own story and inviting us into the light with our own stories. So thank you for that. Friends, please feel free to send your questions, and we will try to address as many as we can tonight. But Roy, as we kick off, two questions for you. First, for those who aren't familiar, tell us what PIR stands for in PIR Ministries and what you all do. And then share with us, you know, for those of us who are pastors or people who are married to pastors who maybe were listening to your story and thinking, you know, that sense of shame, that sense of having secrets that I'm hiding resonates, feels very familiar. You know, Roy, in your story, the circumstances of how your life played out, you were forced out into the light. That wasn't a choice that you were given to make. But for people who are still living in that sense of hiding and secrecy, what might be a good, wise, reasonable first step toward walking away from the darkness of shame and coming into that light of truth and reality to receive God's grace? So first, tell us about PIR, and then what might be a good first step to move out of the hiding?
Sure, yeah, absolutely. So PIR Ministries, PIR is the shortened acronym for Pastor in Residence Ministries. That's our official legal name, which reflects the core process that the ministry was founded on, which has to do with restoring and providing a process of restoration for pastors who have been forced out of their positions, who have had forced exits or difficult transitions out of ministry for a variety of reasons, up and down the spectrum from conflict to moral compromise. Along with that, though, because of what we've learned along the way in that work of what the risk factors are for pastors, we've developed a really solid coaching program. All of our staff members are trained coaches and have pastoral experience and a wealth of connection to Jesus to bring the gospel to bear on our challenges. We do some assessment work that can be helpful in that self-understanding or self-growth piece, so the Pro-D assessment and a pastoral health assessment. We do a lot of coaching around sabbatical planning. We do workshops and seminars on a lot of these issues that we want to help church leaders, even board members and elders, to understand the weight of ministry life so that they can better care for their pastors. And we are connected to a large network of caring ministries. So when we need to refer out to counselors or places where pastors and ministry leaders can go for intensives or long times of quiet and solitude, that we have those resources available. So that's what it stands for, what we do, and what we've been doing for 25 years, almost 26 now. So that's who we are. Yeah. So I have the luxury, and I understand I have the luxury in embracing my story. It was still not easy by any stretch of the imagination, but there was a measure of luxury that my story became public in a hurry. And I was so on my way to a 30-day intensive program right after I was released on bond to my wife. I walked to Chicago O'Hare Airport and saw my picture on all of the papers in the newsstand. So I understand that. I understand that it was a force out into the light. For someone who is trying to figure out what the first step is, figure out who one person who is a safe person that you can begin to share what it is you're challenged with, what that baggage looks like for you. If you're married, hopefully that can be your spouse, but not always. It's in the first step. Sometimes we have to gauge whether what our baggage looks like needs a little work before we can unpack it fully with those who are closest to us. So we need to find that person, though, who is safe, and begin to articulate, to share, to bring all of that into the light. I can't emphasize that enough. There's, you know, we tend in our culture to rely a lot on information, on books and seminars like this, even in webinars and stuff. But there is no substitute for that relational piece. And that's really where it begins. I think that James chapter 5, where it talks about confessing our faults to one another and praying for one another that we might be healed, is the most overlooked or unused passage of scripture, and yet is the most powerful one in this, because that is how we all progress and grow and find the help that we need. So we have to find a safe person to start with. And that can be a counselor, can be a coach, can be a friend, someone who will listen. And you get the chance then to share your story, to acknowledge it. And that's the first step.
Thank you, Roy. We had a question come in here. Can you speak to knowing if and when we should be looking for a ministry that is less harmful to our wives, to our spouses? I wonder if church ministry may not be ideal for our wives who may be neurodivergent. That's a good question, big question.
It is a big question. And I wish my brother was here, who's a psychologist, because he could speak to the second half of that. Yeah, I think that's important to ask that question. To even articulate that, because sometimes we assume that this is the only way, that there's only one way to do ministry, that there's only one path, and there's not. We often talk about understanding the shape of the calling. We never question God's call on anyone's life, but what we want to ask is, what's the right shape for that? Where's the healthiest shape that can take place? And when you have challenges like that in your family, whether it's you personally or a spouse, it's really important to know that it's okay to ask that question and to engage with it seriously and to say, what is the best path for not only how I serve the Lord, but how I serve my family? Because they're not mutually exclusive. And so there are, it doesn't have to be like it unfortunately has been in the past, where pastors will sacrifice their families on the altar of ministry. And that's not what God intends, I believe. So it's a good question. It's an important question. It's a serious question. And it's okay to ask it, and okay to explore it, to see if there might be another way to express that calling that God has on your life.
We had one follow-up question. What is neurodivergent? Roy, do you want to field that one, or do you want me to take a shot at it?
You take a shot at it, because I have only my brief, I mean, I know the term, but I can't really give you a technical definition of it.
Sure. Just quickly, the term neurodivergent has been used more and more recently to address people whose neurological function is different from what's considered typical. So a lot of times I hear the term neurodivergent used for folks who might have an autism spectrum disorder.
Right.
That's the one that's most commonly referred to.
And it does run the spectrum, because I do know that even things like ADD, ADHD, some of those others are also sometimes considered in that category as well.
Very good point. Yes. Yes. Lots of people with ADD and ADHD diagnoses.
Yep. Right. Yep.
Roy, one of the things that you mentioned early in sharing your story with us was that when you came to know the Lord, it was kind of assumed that all your previous baggage would just be done away with almost, in one fell swoop once you came to faith in Christ. And as you struggled, as you came to grips with your own sin, your own brokenness, you also were hoping that the Lord would somehow magically bring healing. Can you talk to us a little bit about what we can do as we serve people in our churches, as we lead either as pastors or people married to pastors? How can we make room for people to bring their full selves to Christ, baggage and all, family history and all? What are some things that we can do to make church a safer place to be a real person?
Yeah, I think that there has to be from the front. Well, in order to build that kind of culture, there has to be trust. There has to be a clear understanding of what the transformation looks like when we come out of darkness into light. That it isn't always, and you have to give God credit that sometimes He does, do a tremendous work in somebody's life and they are completely lifted out. I also know that in some of those stories, the baggage still has to be worked out as well. But so there has to be a culture built of trust and of understanding what the process is. I don't think we really talk about that a lot in discipleship, is what this sanctification process actually looks like. What's the shape of it? So there's things that pastors can do from the front in preaching and teaching. There's work that can be done at the session level and in the culture of the church to just simply acknowledge that people are broken and that we cannot expect people to be perfect and communicate that in effective ways. I also think that there's some discussion, there's ongoing discussion about how much pastors should share of their own journeys from the front. And that can be a tricky situation. You have to be really careful with that and wise. But to find ways to share our own engagement with our brokenness and God's grace is important. And I don't have an answer for everybody on that. I know that in my own journey, it comes out in terms of how I interact with the scriptures personally around issues that I find still troubling for me. But the culture's got to be built, and that takes some time to do that. We can't imagine that simply by saying, okay, well, now we're going to have a culture of vulnerability and openness and authenticity, that it's immediately going to happen. So there have to be steps taken to build trust. And I think that, I will say this, Paul Tripp in his book Lead talks about this, and I really believe it's important, that actually our sessions and our work as pastors with our sessions can really be a great example of this and can set the tone for it. He talks about our leadership as a session, as a group of leaders, as elders, ought to be the safest place in the world to be able to share our journeys and our stories. I don't know that that's true in too many places, but the more work you can do in that area and start building that culture at that ground root level, to create that trust and that vulnerability, then that will spread. You know, those examples will be seen and heard. So I think that probably is a really good place to start, as well as the effective communication in our preaching and our teaching, our discipleship about what this process actually looks like.
Thank you. That's very helpful. Another question. In your work, Roy, what percentage of pastors do you find are on medication for either depression or some sort of other mental health struggle?
I think that, so it would be simply a guess, that to be anecdotal to assign a percentage to that or a number, but we do know that there are a significantly growing number of pastors, especially those who are serving in very difficult places that have no relational support. So there's a significant amount of that. I think even in our culture, the statistics are growing and have been growing for some time of people who are just, they're on the medication, are clinically diagnosed with depression or chronic mental health issues. So you have to admit, you have to understand that a certain percentage of the population who are pastors are going to be facing that. So we do find it. We do know that there are pastors that we work with who are. And unfortunately, that's also another area where the church hasn't always been very understanding. And it hasn't been normalized yet, which it needs to be. We have seen pastors who have been exited because they dared to admit that they suffered with depression and the churches could not handle it. So we need to do a better job in that area.
And that's a big part of why we're here tonight and why we're going to do this series. We want the EPC to be a place where we can be honest about the realities of our mental health and emotional health, whether it's good, bad, or in between. Where we can hopefully, by God's grace, embrace one another and be a community where we are experiencing the grace and healing of God at work amongst us. I would just share, piggybacking on what you said, Roy, in response to that question, I believe in talking with our benefits folks in the EPC, at least for the people that are involved in our benefits program, our mental health needs track with the general population. Mm-hmm. So there's nothing special or unique about being ordained in the EPC or being married or the child of someone who's ordained in the EPC. We have just as many struggles with our mental health and just as much need for clinical support as anybody else. Mm-hmm. Another really good question here, Roy. What is the balance between creating safe places, acknowledging that we are all broken, versus being church leaders who are called to a high biblical standard? Mm-hmm. That's a really, really good question.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So that's always an issue for us in our conversations with church leaders, especially when we're dealing with someone who isn't in a full-blown acting out kind of a place, but who says, hey, I'm challenged, I struggle, you know. It may be that our sense of high biblical standards also includes the sense of our humanity and our brokenness and the process of our sanctification. Being people of integrity means that we would also have that integrity as it relates to our own stories. And so I think we've narrowed that sense of high biblical standards to almost something that if you really applied them as is, there's not a person on the face of the earth who could fulfill them. So there's always a gap between where we are and where we want to be, you know, in our journey. And I'll come around to answering the other side of that. But I think we need to acknowledge that so those safe places need to be had so that when someone, here's the thing, when someone is on the cusp, you want to be able to help them not fall over the edge. And we don't do a really good job of that. Our ministry, unfortunately, for a long time, has been clean up on aisle 10. So we're always following up, and the church is always following up and reacting rather than being proactive about this. And in some cases, coming back around to that, in some cases, it may be that someone does need to step away for a while. You know, that's not inappropriate to say for their health, for their the life of their soul and their family, they need to step back and say, I've got some work I need to do. You know, it's not a disqualification. It's a proactive realization that I'm facing something that puts me in jeopardy of being able to serve the church in a healthy way. So that's not inappropriate. But far too often, and I will say this without question, far too often we jump the gun, we react, and we will shut people down and cut people off and leave them behind, which only then communicates to the larger body, don't share, don't be real. And that is disastrous.
Perfect follow-up question here, Roy. Someone's asking, you know, just right along with what you're saying, since the church has a habit of shooting her wounded, how can I signal that I will not do that? How can I be of help to others, in other words?
Mm-hmm. Coming with a posture of being a listener, of your own humility, and being in those times when you really need to, in those individual relationships, being able to share your own story, again, it creates that safe space for others who recognize them, that you're not going to be one of those who's going to turn them off, turn them away. You know, I'd like to have a silver bullet for us organizationally to be able to do that. It takes a long time to build a culture that communicates that. But on an individual basis, anybody can signal to others by a posture of humility, by a posture of curiosity and listening, and not either condemning or trying to fix, but simply say, I'm here. I want to walk with you. And I'll share a little bit of my story so that you know that I'm a safe person.
Beautiful. Roy, just real quickly again, remind us about the range of services that PIR provides, and then tell people how they can get a hold of you.
Yeah. So if you find yourself or know of someone who is facing a forced termination or has been terminated and exited from the ministry, then please get in touch with us. That is a core process, and we have a robust and effective process of working through that for healing and restoration so that the next chapter can be entered into in a healthy way. So the Pastor in Residence Program is that. We do our coaching work, which is one-on-one coaching. And we find that to be very beneficial for pastors who are facing ministry challenges and life challenges. The assessment work that we do, the Prodi assessment, I can't recommend that highly enough, even for someone who may not be looking at a transition, but is simply wanting to get a better understanding of how God has wired them and affirming their calling and the shape of it. Or maybe they need it to be able to stay with their session. Here's how I'm wired. Maybe we need to make some adjustments in my role so that it can be a win-win. A lot of ways that can be used. Sabbatical planning work that we do. So if you're thinking about a sabbatical, then we are glad to be able to walk you through that and create a good plan for that. And then anytime that you need someone to share with your session, your church, or your presbytery, about some of these issues, we have a wonderful workshop that we call Cultivating a Culture of Ministry Health, which goes to this idea of that culture that you can build and how you start building that. And that's certainly something we've done in more than half of the presbyteries in EPC. And if you haven't been in that yet, then we would love to come and be a part of that for you. And then it's just, you know, building relationships with pastors. That's what we all love to do on the team. All of us, we have formal coaching, we have formal work that we do, but then there's a ton of just somebody can pick up the phone and say, hey, I need somebody to listen to me for a minute, and we're there. So you can do that. So how do you get in touch with us? Our website is PIRministries.org, and you can contact us through that, or you can email info@PIRministries, or you can email me at Roy@PIRministries, or you can call, if you're a calling person, 844-585-1234. Very simple telephone number. We also have a Facebook page. You might want to message us through that. So those are all the ways that we can be reached. And we want to hear from you and share your journey with you if that's appropriate and the Lord will.
Excellent. Thank you so much, Roy. Friends, you'll see in the chat there, I included the links. I intended them to be links. It looks like they didn't come through that way, but PIRministries.org, info@PIRministries.org, or Roy@PIRministries.org. And let me just put in a plug here for my good friend. If you would like Roy to come and talk with your session, to talk with your church, to talk with your presbytery, please don't hesitate to reach out to him. He has presented more than once at my presbytery, and our pastors and our ruling elders have always really appreciated the workshops that Roy has done. So there you have a way to get in touch with Roy if you would like to connect him with your church or your presbytery. I also wanted to put in a couple other quick plugs here for other opportunities coming up. We have a cohort starting after Easter, so mid-April. We have a pastoral growth cohort that will be meeting online twice a month. There's a link there. You can register online if you're interested. And we're going to continue this Healthy Pastors, Healthy Families webinar series next month on Monday, March 18th with Reverend Bonnie Gatchell. Bonnie is the executive director of Route One Ministry based in Boston, but she has been traveling all over the country doing a presentation on trauma, abuse, and the value of a healthy church response. And she has agreed to share that presentation with us next month. So please mark your calendars for March 18th with Bonnie Gatchell. And don't hesitate to reach out to us. We would love to serve you in any way we can as we all seek to live in the grace and the health and wholeness of Christ. God bless you all. Roy, thank you so much for being with me.
My
and pleasure. Good night.
Good night.